feel free to ask, because especially when we give lectures online, many times it happens like we missed some questions. So if you have any questions, you can ask anytime. Does anyone want to break? I think
fine.
Okay. So today's topic is a woman support workshop, and today we are going to talk about age cycle of a woman. Then we will talk what is a monthly cycle or for women, and we will see menstruation from the modern point of view. Then later slides we will study about PMS or premenstrual symptoms. And we'll talk about menopause, and at the end we will see a different Ayurvedic protocols to balance all these conditions. So age cycle of a woman. So we all know, according to Ayurveda, the humans are kind of classified into three age groups, like Vata age, Pitta age and Kapha age. But for women, they are also classified in a different category. So first one is Balya, or it's from birth to puberty, or like before age of 13 years. And this phase is ruled by Kapha Dosha, or it's the classic Kapha age. The second is Yuvati. In this category, we can say it starts from the puberty to from puberty to 40 years of life. And third one is Proudham, that means 40 to 50 years, or we can call it this 10-year period as a perimenopausal, like 5 years before the menopause, 5 years after the menopause. And this phase is kind of ruled by Pitta and Vata dosha together. And after that, the last age is Vruddhavastha, or it is above 50 years of age. And this is like a postmenopausal, and this is ruled by Vata dosha. So this classification of age is for women. Okay. So this is actually a diagram about female reproductive system. So over here you can see uterus, this is a vagina, this part is cervix. And these two like hand-like structures, these are the fallopian tubes. And these round, like these ones, are the ovaries. So this is the anatomical picture of female reproductive system. So this female reproductive system is actually connected with our brain, or to be very specific, it is connected to the pituitary gland in the brain. And this pituitary gland secretes various hormones. For example, it secretes follicle stimulating hormone, or we can call it FSH. This FSH hormone kind of gives signal to these ovaries, and in the ovaries you will find different follicles, and these follicles will start getting bigger and bigger, and once, or we can say, they will start getting mature, and when they will become mature, they will release an egg. That's what we call it as a ovulation. So in each female, you can get like 450,000 eggs throughout her life. So those many number of eggs every female has. So when the eggs get released, the fallopian tubes kind of captures it, and from the fallopian tubes, it kind of travels inside the uterus, and over here, it will try to implant inside the uterus. So for implantation, it has to have fertilization, should have in place. So just in case during the period of, or I will say after the ovulation, if the female comes in the contact with the male, then this ovum or this egg can unite with the sperm, and the zygote will form, and then that fertilized egg can get implanted anywhere inside the uterus. But just in case if the egg is not fertilized, or if she doesn't comes in contact with male, then in that case the egg remains unfertilized. So the body will try to make it implant, but as it is not fertilized egg, the uterus will not allow it to get implanted. So that's why at that point you will get your period. So that's the menstrual cycle.
So when you say that it's connected to the brain, the pituitary gland,
So you mean that according to how we have been during our month, our cycle dates can change if we had over hyperactive or
yes. So for example, if the person is having any kind of a pituitary disorder or Cushing syndrome, or if he's having thyroid imbalances, naturally his pituitary functions are also disturbed. So in that cases, this normal ovulation or the normal period process is also gets hampered. So that's why you will get either irregular periods or heavy bleeding, or many times women will not get their first period at the age of 16. So all these are issues related with the hormone imbalances. So the common terms during this presentation, you will see the first one is menstruation. That means the monthly cycle or monthly period. Second one is menarche. So menarche is the very first period in the life of a woman, and it can start between age of 12 to 13. And men means monthly, and arch means beginning. So that's the beginning of the monthly period. And the interesting thing is, especially coming over here, I heard that now women are really kind of a proactive, and they literally celebrate their daughter's first period, and they have like a menarche parties, so just like a 16-year birthday party. So they will also celebrate like a menarche parties over here. So that's a kind of an interesting thing, and it's a really good thing because it's a kind of a change from girlhood to the womanhood, and it's the periods kind of give us idea about the women's fertile period in her life, because that's the correct time she can start having kids or babies. The second third term you will come across is premenopausal. So that means 10 years before the menopause. And menopause is the complete cessation of monthly cycle. Menos means monthly, and pause is the complete cessation. And last term is postmenopausal, that refers to the 10 years period after the menopause.
Why is there a pre and postmenopausal? How do they differentiate from
symptoms wise?
Yeah.
Yes.
Menopause.
We will talk about that in the later slides. So we are going to discuss menopause in detail. So according to Ayurveda, menstruation is it's not just like a 5-day bleeding period. It's more like a cleansing process, I will say. It's a physical cleansing, emotional cleansing, and a spiritual cleansing. So at this period, like all those physical imbalances or the physical impurities from our body kind of washes out during the menstrual period. Emotionally, it is a cleansing process, because that time, that's the time when you should try considering or cleansing out your mind as well. So especially that period, women are advised to take a rest, they are advised to meditate, and it's a kind of a time when you can focus more on yourself, and you can learn about like what's happening in your mind, or is there anything kind of a problems. You can work on those problems, because that's the time you will have to think over, and it's a kind of a cleansing process. So while your body is kind of physically getting cleansed, you can cleanse your mind as well by eating like a light diet, soft diet, and meditation. And another important thing is avoid performing any kind of a physical demanding type of activities. So just like Monica ji mentioned, like avoid doing hiking, running around, just try to take rest as much as possible. But rest doesn't mean that you have to take like a complete bed rest. So you can do all your mundane day-to-day activities, but just avoid any stressful situation, or just follow your daily routine, I will say. So during the ovulation, we have seen some So this is just a chart or a graph. So this is the fifth day of a menstrual period. So during this time, your bleeding kind of stops, and that time again the process of ovulation starts. So your brain gives signals to the follicles or follicles in the ovaries to stimulate to start their maturing. So at that time, these follicles release a hormone, and it's called as estrogen hormone. So this estrogen hormone is more like a kapha thing, I will say. It helps to mature that follicle. It builds up the endometrial lining, and it kind of creates that uterus lining, kind of a soft like a pillow thing. It kind of nourishes the uterine lining, so that whenever the egg will get fertilized, it will have like a nice spot to get implant. So that's the kind of a building of the endometrial lining takes place by estrogen hormone. But at the day 14th, if the woman doesn't come in contact with sperm or anything, or the egg doesn't get fertilized, the estrogen hormone level drops and the progesterone hormone starts increasing up. So in this time, it will try to implant that egg, but as it is not fertilized egg, it will not get implanted. And because of that, it will release a lot of progesterone just to help that egg in implantation. But at the end of 28th day, as there is no fertilization, again your menstrual cycle will start, and again you will get the bleeding for 4 to 5 days. So that's how the estrogen level goes up and the progesterone level goes up. So according to Ayurveda, this menstrual cycle is also governed by doshas. So first dosha is kapha dosha. It's in the action from day 5th to day 14th. So during this period, generally women notice they kind of show weight gain, little bit. They kind of high energy, I will say, or and they are kind of a calm, but with the kind of a good energy or good stamina. And all that kapha dosha is kind of a building a uterus, or it is kind of helping to get ready for implantation. So after second phase is from day 14 to day 28th. So again, it is a 14 day phase, and this is governed by pitta dosha. So during pitta dosha, progesterone hormone is kind of at its peak. So many times women gets like a small pimples or acne during this period, and many times they will get little bit of mood swings or irritability. It's all because of the pitta is in that phase. And at the end of the 28th day, or where the bleeding starts, so that phase is governed by vata dosha. So if there is any issues with apanvayu specifically, then the period will be either short, scanty, or it will have like a lot of pain associated with, lot of backache, cramping in the legs. So all these issues are related with vata dosha. So depending upon like which dosha is imbalanced, you can see different symptoms during your month. So first is like many times, especially when you will start taking your case studies, clients will come, and if you ask them how is your monthly period or how is your monthly cycle, they will say my cycle is okay, my cycle is regular. And then you will ask them, do you get clots? They will say, yeah, I do get clots. Is it painful? Yeah, it's very painful. I have to rest the whole day. I cannot do anything. So many times people don't know what is a normal, what is a normal cycle. So the first thing is a normal cycle generally lasts about 4 to 5 days, and it will have a moderate flow. There will be no clots, no discomfort. Many times no discomfort means they can perform their various daily activities without taking any pills or without having like a good amount of rest, or they can just do their routine. Many times discomfort or slight discomfort, you can say it's a little bit of pain, like you not even notice it, so that much low pain, I can say. And In the Kapha phase, it's the end of the bleeding to the ovulation. It's the building up of the endometrial lining. Pitta phase, from ovulation to the starting of the menses. And Vata phase is governed by Apanvata. And actually this Apanvayu helps in the excretion of the menstrual fluid. Now the question is, what happens if the woman is on the birth control pills? Any idea? Anybody knows what is the combination of birth control pills?
Yeah, I don't know. It's my case studies with when the client's on birth control, I don't really know how to
adjust for that.
Yeah.
It totally interferes with your natural cycle.
Yeah, I don't even know how to even deal with their whole women's cycle.
Yeah. Are they always, their body thinks they're always pregnant? Is that the?
No.
It tricks the body into thinking that you're menstruating, but you're not. Is that?
Yeah. Similar, I would say.
Yeah, if you're someone that has irregular cycles, it puts you on a regular cycle.
Okay. So, let's talk about all these issues. So, birth control pills are kind of a chemically altered. So, these are the kind of artificial hormones that you can get in the pill. So, many times it's a combination of estrogen and the progesterone hormones. And we have seen that these two hormones play important role in the menstruation. So, so whenever the person or that lady takes a birth control pills, our pituitary gland doesn't need to secrete any hormones to give signal to the ovaries to mature that follicle, because it's already in there and it's a kind of a hormone-based pill. So the follicles kind of mature, but they don't release an egg, because all these hormones are kind of just the pills, because of what happens in our body. So when our pituitary gland gives a signal to ovaries that you have to mature follicle, at that time it will start maturing particular follicle, and that follicle releases estrogen hormone. So in this case, if you are taking the pills externally, like if you are taking estrogen hormone externally, then these follicles don't even mature. So they remain as it is, or we can say they remain in the dormant stage. So your ovaries are not at all functioning in this phase. So you are getting your hormones. So just like we see in the next slide of for the first 14 day, your pill has a large amount of estrogen, so you are just taking external pill of that estrogen hormone. So there is no ovulation, so just you are getting estrogen hormone, and at the end of these periods, you will get the progesterone hormone. That's another hormone that's available in the pills, and at the later stages of the pills, they reduce the dose of estrogen in those pills, so that's why you get the bleeding, because of the withdrawal of the estrogen and progesterone.
Is bleeding, but there is no ovulation.
Yes, there is bleeding, but no ovulation. So your ovaries are doing nothing; they are just sitting as it is.
So is the bleeding? It's like a forced bleeding in a way, right?
Yeah, it's a forced
really
bleeding.
Like the natural.
So it's not a cleansing process.
Right.
So it's just the hormonal, they are taking advantage of the hormones.
Mm.
But the bleeding is supposed to be the egg, right? But if the egg is not formed, where is the blood coming from?
It's supposed to be the endometrial lining.
Because of the endometrial lining.
Yeah.
Because the egg, when egg releases, that follicles kind of secretes both estrogen and progesterone hormones. But now you are getting those two hormones externally. So you are not getting egg, but only those two hormones. So that's why you get the bleeding, and it's without ovulation. So just in case during this period, if she comes in the contact with male, but there is no ovum, so that's why she cannot get fertilized. So that's how they work as a birth control pills. So it is a kind of a separation of the natural and the physiological cycle of a female body. So ovaries remain dormant in this stage. Actually, I have like a very classical case study. When I was living in Washington DC, I have a friend. She heard about me that I do all these Ayurvedic things, and one day she came to me, "Hey, I was trying to get pregnant and we are trying for almost like 3 months and nothing is happening. Can you help me with it?" I said, "Yeah, I can help you out." Then I asked her what's going on, and then she told me she started on the birth control pills at the age of 18 years, and now she was like 26 years at that time, and for like almost 10-12 years she's taking those pills continuously without interruption, and now she got married, and if she wants to have baby, so she stopped taking the pills for like 2 months back, and now she's, "No, I'm not getting any periods or nothing, I'm not getting pregnant." Then I told her the main thing is because your body, or I will say ovaries, got kind of a totally forgot how to produce an egg. Mm-hmm. So that's why you are getting kind of a, there is no ovulation is happening. So that's why you will not get pregnant immediately. So whenever I will definitely suggest if you are using birth control pills, always give gap of like 2 months, 3 months in between. So just use the pills for like 2 months, then give again gap for 2 months. So that way your body will memorize that you have to work with your ovaries. So otherwise these things are very common. And once you are on that pills longer time, there are chances that you will get a lot of vitamin deficiency. So especially vitamin B6, B12, zinc, magnesium.
But then you hear about these girls who like don't take their birth control for like one day and they get pregnant.
Yeah.
It's just really weird. I mean, I took birth control for 8 years and I've been on it for, off of it for a year and a half, and I haven't had a cycle. It's crazy.
How long does it usually take for your menstrual cycle to kind of kick back into its natural?
It depends upon like your hormone levels and how long you are taking the period. If you have like a severe fracture and if your hand is in the plaster for like 12 weeks or something, and after that, when you try to bend it, it kind of really hurts. And especially if it's like a small joint or a small like a hand fracture, I will say you get kind of a really difficult time writing your name. Yes, so it's the same thing, like body has to get into the action.
Yeah, so I'm just thinking how this taking birth control would contribute to ovarian cancer if those eggs aren't being produced.
Yeah.
Have you have too many eggs in your ovaries?
Yes, the ovaries remain,
So if you have all of the eggs that
you're
aren't
never
being released,
losing those eggs.
What happens?
They're just
staying it.
So
it's a kind of a, I will say it's a kind of a mala from Ayurvedic point of view.
So
it's accumulation of
cancer.
The mala, yes,
yeah.
That can cause cancer.
So what happens
to those
eggs?
Have they done research about that, how the pill would contribute to ovarian cancer? I don't know, I'll never look.
So if you take it for 20 years, you have all those eggs that haven't been released, what happens to those eggs?
Those will remain as it is.
Oh.
They'll never go away, they stay in your body?
No.
All
right.
Oh.
Aren't there any Ayurvedic ways of birth control, like any pills or...
That would be nice.
Yes, there are actually some Ayurvedic ways of birth control.
How does Ayurveda feel about an IUD?
I will say it's just the same way. It's short-term use is okay, because IUD is also has a kind of a coating of the hormones.
And you're defining short-term like 2 months?
2 months or 3 months.
Uh-huh.
But make sure you are giving a gap in between.
Mm-hmm. But you still ovulate with an IUD.
Yes, but still you are getting the
hormones. What about a non-hormonal IUD?
Copper?
Yeah, copper tea.
Copper one.
Is that one okay or no?
Yeah, that one is okay. But again, copper tea has its other side effect. It has to be changed because a copper is a kind of a metal and it comes in the contact with your mucosal lining, and it can corrode up the skin. Not the skin, I will say mucosal lining. It has a toxic effect. So.
Okay. I know, I've been looking through some. Can't find anything.
There's nothing.
Yeah. So for the Ayurvedic... birth control, the common one is used hibiscus paste, hibiscus flower paste. So you can just insert it in the vagina.
Interesting.
So it has a kind of anti-spermicidal actions. Neem paste is also good. Yes.
So you just apply it before and or you keep regularly applying it?
No, just before it. So and another is castor seeds. You have to take the castor seeds, open it, and there is a kind of a white seed inside that big seed. So you have to eat those within like 72 hours of contact. So this is for the after use. Castor seeds.
Castor?
Interesting.
Castor.
C-A-S-T-O-R.
Yeah.
C-A-S-T-O-R. What the oil is made of, right?
Yes, castor oil.
Extraction oil.
Seeds.
Yes.
So taking castor
yes.
oil.
You have to open the seeds and inside the seeds you will see the white thing.
Okay.
Can you apply that?
So you can't
you eat it.
You can't just take castor oil.
No, castor oil doesn't
doesn't
help.
But you don't want to anyway.
So you're saying you can take that after you eat it after or before?
After.
So like 7 minutes.